Hi, welcome to the podcast by Dr. Sushma Singh. Let us start conversation on Unit 5, Education, Knowledge and Power. And our topic of discussion is cultural and economic reproduction. Education becomes the site for the reproduction and production of power relation in society. Education becomes a tool to dominate, to impose ideas, meanings and practices on people in a civilized democratic way. The kind of oppression is subtle and is not undemocratic. Through education, the dominant section of society hegemonizes the common sense, making exploitation appear neutral or natural. Apple asserts that education and differential cultural, economic and the political power should be seen as closely connected with each other. The educational policies and practices are the result of struggles by powerful groups to legitimize their knowledge and their viewpoint. This authenticates the pattern of social mobility and increases their power in society. Based on a study of schooling in American society, Bowles and the Gintins stress the economic role of educational institutions. They mention that the educational institutions play a paramount role in producing the division of labor in society, sustaining class divisions. For this reason, Apple explores the relationship between the economic and cultural domination because of which inequality in society is reproduced. He mentions that one of the important ways through which dominant groups are able to exert their power is through the control of the governmental mechanisms that grant official legitimacy to particular groups' knowledge. One such way is through the process of state textbook adoption. Textbooks are an important medium for exercising control as they embody dominant ideologies. In textbook, knowledge continues to be inherently ideological as it reproduces the culture of dominant class and perpetuates the established patterns of social order and social inequality. These biased textbooks allow the hegemony of dominant groups to continue and the hierarchical social order is preserved. Timothy Scares, in his examination of the textbooks of West Bengal, finds that the text and the images are ideologically biased. He placed the characters and the stories on the dimensions of the time and space and finds that while upper class occupations are identified more with the present, those of the lower caste are related with the past. This reinforces the notion of lower caste closeness with technological backwardness and social irrelevance. The children of the lower castes are disadvantaged as their own cultural experiences are denied the legitimation of being the real and valued knowledge. Texts either do not represent the experiences of lower caste people, and if they do represent, then it is in a distorted form. Whenever the lower caste have attempted to challenge the established hierarchical order, they have been demeaned and ridiculed on the ideological and cultural grounds. Dominant groups use knowledge in a way that no voices other than their own are represented. If they get represented, then only in a feeble, inadequate or distorted way, which gives them a negative appeal. This is a civilized dynamic form of assertion through which the dominant ideology continues to perpetuate its domination. The school disseminates certain forms of knowledge through which people can be controlled. They not just control people, but also they control meaning. Both of them influence each other. School disseminate legitimate knowledge, the knowledge of specific group under the illusion of belonging to everyone. Just the fact that the particular knowledge is provided and distributed by the school gives legitimacy to that knowledge and to that particular group also, which feels close to that knowledge. In this way, it becomes easy to control people by controlling meaning. The group getting substantial representation in the curriculum should have the political and economic power to make their knowledge, their life world and their worldview into knowledge for all. Culture and culture capital are also used for this and cannot be seen as apolitical entities. Therefore, power and culture are interwoven and mutually influence each other so that both economic power and cultural power give better agencies for social control. Foucault provides an analysis of knowledge and finds the complex relationship existing between forms of knowledge and relations of power. He finds a circular relationship between the systems of power and regimes of knowledge. Through knowledge, control is exercised and order is imposed. This is the dialectic of the knowledge and control. John Fiske also shares the same critical Foucauldian thought. For him, knowledge is never neutral. It never exists in an imperialistic objective relationship to the real. Knowledge is power, and the circulation of knowledge is part of the social distribution of power. The education and power linkage becomes vivid when the deliberation, selection and organization of knowledge is studied critically. Selective tradition, ideology and hegemony are three critical terms used by Apple for his analysis. Let us understand these terms here. The deliberate selection of knowledge in any text allows social control and social inequality to continue. Williams calls this selection as selective tradition and defines it as someone's selection, someone's vision of legitimate knowledge and culture, one that in the process of enfranchising one group's cultural capital disenfranchise another's. Through the process of selective tradition, educational curriculum acts as agents of both cultural and ideological control. It legitimates, neutralizes and authenticates the culture and knowledge of the dominant group. Ideology refers to the system of ideas, beliefs or values about the social reality, but this is a simplistic way of understanding it. Marx explains ideology as a form of false consciousness which distorts one's picture of social reality and serves the interest of the dominant classes in a society. It provides a justification of their vested interest and gives them a liberal, ostensible appearance. To understand what ideology is, one has to investigate what is considered to be legitimate knowledge in specific institutions at a specific historical moment. For Apple, the overt and covert knowledge found within school settings and the principles of selection, organization and evaluation of this knowledge are value-governed selections from a much larger universe of possible knowledge and selection principles. Hence, whatever school teach as accurate knowledge and as representing collective tradition is in fact the life world of only a few. Through the overt and the hidden curricula, it is the meaning and the life worlds of the dominant in society, which is being collected and distributed. Not all groups' visions and meanings and are represented, and this becomes possible through ideology. Hegemony saturates our consciousness so that the educational, economic and the social reality we see and interact with seems to be the only one. It refers to those organized assemblies of meanings, values and actions that are adhered to in the course of life. It is through hegemony that the control over people resources becomes smooth. For William, schools become agents of cultural and ideological hegemony. Education may be viewed as a hegemonic form because its ideological saturation permeates our lived experience and enables them to believe they are neutral participants in the neutral instrumentation of schooling. On the contrary, they serve the economic and ideological interests of the popular and elite culture. Here we wind up the conversation, and thank you so much for choosing this podcast.